I want to welcome you to the 10th annual Odyssey Awards Luncheon.
We can make a huge difference, a huge wave, a tsunami, if you say it, to our girls, our community, and legacy of lifetime from this point forward. How are y'all going to challenge me to do more? I will match every dollar you give today.
So please join me today in welcoming CGLA's co-founder and one of the founding mothers of our peaceful revolution, Maxine Bailey.
10 years, y'all. I never thought that I would fall in love with a number, but I have fallen in love with 10. 10 years. You know, when you're part of a STEM school, numbers have a special significance. So I am in love with 10. And this is for my fellow revolutionaries. They told us we couldn't do it, so we did.
As one of the founding members of CGLA Governance Board and the Young Women's Leadership Academy Board, it is my honor to present the Founders Leadership Award. This award was established to commemorate the vision and dedication of the founders of the Chattanooga Girls Leadership Academy. As some of you know, I'm on a number of boards. This woman supports everybody, but she especially supports the girls of CGLA. And she is responsible. Many people contribute to it, but she rises above the rest in understanding that this is about transforming the lives of girls. We have done it. We continue to do it, and we want you to know that your contribution has certainly made that happen. So thank you so much, Joanne. Thank you.
So at this time, we're going to recognize the Rising Star Award finalists. This year, our finalists are both eighth graders, Kelly Perez Hernandez and Yesenia Pablo Rafael. While both of these girls are most definitely winners, I'd like to first recognize the runner-up for the Rising Star Award, Yesenia Pablo Rafael. And at this time, I'd like to welcome to the stage the 2019 Rising Star Award winner, Kelly Perez Hernandez. Congratulations.
My name is Kelly Perez Hernandez, and I am in the eighth grade at CGLA. CGLA has prepared me to succeed in a STEM career in many ways. Being at CGLA has made me become a better person. They have helped me realize the person I want to become. When I first came to CGLA, I knew that I wanted to be an engineer. When I was in the sixth grade, my teachers assigned us a presentation about our future careers in STEAM. I started researching more about engineering, and I decided that I was going to pursue a career in civil engineering. CGLA focuses on preparing us for college. We are currently working on building a mobile robot in our project-based learning groups. This will help me in the future as I gain the knowledge to become a civil engineer. Before I came to CGLA, I was shy and had very few friends. Whenever I spoke quietly. After I came to CGLA, everything changed. My teachers helped me realize that if I wanted something to happen, I had to speak out. I had to make sure people heard me. I became more vocal, I started to become more social, and I started to have confidence in myself. I decided that I was not going to let people's words affect my effort, because if I let their words get to me, I wouldn't make any progress. I am going to focus on succeeding because CJLA has provided me with the tools that I need to be successful. I also learned that it's up to me to make good use of those opportunities that I have been provided. CJLA encourages us to take our chances. Our teachers always tell us that they want us to see us become someone important in life. They want us to be strong and brave. They want to see us become leaders. CJLA has changed my life in so many ways, and I know that with their help, I will be able to succeed in a STEAM career. Thank you.
Now we're going to turn our attention to the Shining Star Award presentation. Our Shining Star Award finalists are Anyang Ayai, who is in 11th grade, and Kerrigan Collins, a 10th grader. Each of these women are role models to their peers and are poised for success as they complete their high school and move on into college and their entire future journey. You're going to be hearing those names again, so you might want to write those down as well. You should both be so proud of yourselves today. While both of these girls are shining a very, very bright light, I'd like to first recognize our runner-up for the Shining Star Award, Kerrigan Collins. Kerrigan, you are an inspiration to all of us. And now I'd like to welcome to the stage the 2019 Shining Star Award recipient, Anyang Ayai. Congratulations.
My very first day at CJLA started off with a bundle of nerves knotting themselves in my stomach. A million different thoughts raced through my mind as I walked the short, infinite distance from my dad's car to the cafeteria. Would the teachers like me? Would I make friends? Would the work be hard? When classes were up and running, I was fully thrust into the world of STEAM. In Mrs. Mount's class, I learned about biomes, energy, and the engineering design process. That year, my first PBL project was a roller coaster I designed with my peers for a fictional amusement park. Last quarter, I created a photobioreactor system that grows algae, which sequesters carbon dioxide emissions and increases oxygen levels. This quarter, I am creating an energy-efficient trailer home for a person that has been struck by a natural disaster. In these past 6 years, CJLA has exposed me to the various STEAM principles and the infinite possibilities they present. The CJLA curriculum has challenged me to question and to reason, to push the boundaries of what is possible. It has given me the chance to pursue passions rooted in the analytical and the creative, the hard sciences and the humanities, making them an integral part of my identity. Upon the completion of my education at CJLA, I plan on pursuing a double major in molecular and physiological biology and biochemistry while minoring in theater. I will go on to medical school and earn my doctorate of medicine with a concentration in neuro, neonatal, or cardiothoracic surgery. In my journey beyond the four walls of CJLA, I hope to still carry my passions for all areas of the STEAM fields. I am thankful to the committee for bestowing me with this award, to the incredible faculty and staff that engage in students on a deeply intellectual level, and to my peers for being a constant force that motivates and inspires me. Lastly, I am thankful to my family, whose steadfast support has been a pure strength in my world. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Those girls prepared their own speeches, by the way. Aren't they wonderful? Let's give them another round of applause. So, good afternoon, and thank each and every one of you for joining us in our 10th anniversary of CGLA. Our odyssey, this journey since 09, teaching girls and empowering girls how to find their voices and thrive. And in our case, an educational journey. And today, every year I've had a theme, and today is no different. I borrowed this, the 10th degree. 10th is an anniversary, but I want to use degree as a verb to notch it up, to increase intensity, to make it 10 times better, this journey, this advantaged education that we're offering girls that otherwise may remain in a disadvantaged situation. Now, during my last 7 years that began with Mr. Beck in August in 2012, I summed up this new challenge in two words, purposeful and intentional. The goal then was to remain a school and to avoid that closure list, but more importantly, to live up to that journey that we had promised these girls. We did, and by the end of 2012-13, we'd improved data exponentially. We survived. There was a reason for that song. You heard them. I will survive. Staying alive. Staying alive. It's not my next career. I recall using the word covenant, as in Sue Ann's words and promise to these girls, that even when on the brink of closure, we were to remain purposed in creating these rising and shining stars that you heard from today. And we ended 2013 with the quote from her, as a matter of fact. Without ambition, one starts nothing. And without work, one certainly finishes nothing. And those ambitions and that hard work led us to the announcement, if we take a look back and forward, led us to the announcement that we were removed in 2014 from that state priority list. We moved on in 2015 to a theme of full steam ahead because we realized that it's not always, that impact is not always about chasing a state assessment test or a score, but no, we knew that we had to impart and sow seeds of knowledge of patience and kindness and hope and expectations in our students. And remember, in 2013, you'll see here in just a minute, we were 22 out of 22 high schools in Hamilton County in ACT scores. We began, however, to witness that journey, that odyssey. And in 2015, you can see that yellow tab up there. We went from 13.8 to 18.1 in ACT. We knew that wasn't good enough, but boy, it was better than being dead last. We had a young lady that year to move from 14 to 19 to 14 to 27 and on to 28. And those numbers were from a previously low-performing school. And by the way, we did not change the demographics of our children to get there. You heard from a junior. We stay on our mission. You just heard from a junior with an ACT super score, the young lady that was in tears, of 30, and that's not her final. Yes, I want her to be my doctor. That's what happens when adults inspire and stretch children academically. And last year at the luncheon, moving forward, we turned our attention to mentoring. We support 5 mentoring programs in our building. It's really important. Just to mention, too, workplace mentoring. We bring the children to you. Some of you participate, and thank you so much, employers, for doing that. But also in our building, we have every employee, including myself, has multiple mentees. And just to mention one, I had a student who had gone to her mentor about 2 weeks ago, and her father was taken into custody, you know, of an immigration issue, and she had no way home. The only car was taken. That mentor, who is here today, assured her safety to home late in the evening. That's why we have mentoring. And here's a Facebook post from a hashtag very satisfied parent. She said, CGLA educators give all of themselves to our girls. So moving on to the present and the future, for the first time in 7 years, our girls have a cafeteria, a library, and a medical clinic operation. And we're in the phase of starting an endowment campaign, and we're embracing an elementary school. Why? Because we have proof that particularly with these last three classes between 16 and 18, that we have impact potentially early. And this year, we're graduating the class that Mr. Beck and I arrived with. Thank you, Mr. Beck, for being with me for 7 years, which brings me to this, back to this 10th year anniversary and back to ACT measures in preparation for taking students beyond that 12th grade year. Recall, we were dead last, and now look, our junior class last year led the county and the state with a 20.4 ACT average. Yeah. Why is this important? I heard an acronym, ACT, Action Changes Things. We put into action our CGLA vision. We are empowering girls to possess infinite choices. Our girls are the women who will be sitting around that table of their choice. You see, I was in my fourth construction project meeting on campus at that table just 2 or 3, 4, 5 weeks ago, and it dawned on me that not one woman around that table was an architect or a construction engineer or a supervisor of that project. But as promised 6 years ago, things are changing. We've realized a 90% average of students going into college, and we will see our first CGLA graduates next year changing the narrative in the workplace and in STEM. We have students attending universities who are majoring in engineering and nursing and business management and, thank God, teaching, pharmacy tech. You just heard molecular biology. In the near future, we will have women from CGLA around the table as engineers and supervisors, storytellers of their own journey. I won't be telling that story. Our young women from the first all-girls STEM charter school in the state of Tennessee, they're being inspired to possess infinite choices in their future. The 10th degree thing, it also calls me to muse and to search for at least 10 actions or words to change that narrative, that deficit narrative, as we usually speak it. What if we said, rather than disadvantaged, soon to be superior, rather than low income, working with our soon to be middle and upper class citizens, rather than deficit, working with abundant seeking citizens? Wow, that's the dream. Thanks, Dr. Wells, for giving our team the opportunity to change this narrative, to create equity in a very unlevel playing field, and to become part of that revolution to teach young women how to make the most of their journey. Thank you for celebrating with us today with the Chattanooga Girls Leadership Academy. Thank you so much.
I am excited and honored to once again introduce Wintley Phipps. As some of you remember, he spoke at our 2017 Odyssey and is back with us by popular demand.
Hello. I've sung all over the world, but never with Chattanooga princesses. And do they look awesome? Give them a big hand. I've been asked to say just a few words before we sing together. You know, we may dream alone, but we never achieve alone. We need people to come around us, support us. And as I was sitting there, I was thanking God for Sue Ann, for the Harrison family, for what your mother taught you, for supporters like the Hutton family and the Yates family. You know, God wants us to always remember He gives us blessings not to hoard, but to share. Even the little bee knows that where he gets his nectar, he has to leave some pollen. He's smart enough to know. And finally, God gave me a quote. When your path in life becomes one of privilege, and you do not remember the innocent you have left behind, your privilege will soon cease to be a blessing and become your greatest curse. Let me say that one more time. When your path in life becomes one of privilege, and you do not remember the innocent you have left behind, your privilege will soon cease to be a blessing and become your greatest curse. Thank you for every one of you who have supported these young girls. And thank you for the privilege of being with you again. I love to sing. I have a personal dream when I get to heaven. I'll be working on my mansion with my holy hammer. And I'll hear a knock on the door, and Jesus will be standing there. He'll say, "Son, I'm about to go to some parts of my universe where they've never seen a child from earth who has been redeemed. Oh, and I want you to come go with me. Oh, and by the way, I want you to sing just before I speak." That's my dream. So listen to this first song. I hope you're blessed. Thank you.
Bye.
Awesome. If that don't light your fire, your wood is wet. Woo, so much joy, so much joy. That's a Negro spiritual called Kumbaya, come by here, Lord. And this one is one of my favorite spirituals. It puts 3 and 4 Bible stories in one song. And listen, I hope you're blessed. Listen to my story. It's the story about my Jesus. Amen. Amen. See the little baby. Amen. Wrapped up in a manger. On Christmas morning. By the seashore, talking to the fishermen, and he's making them disciples. Amen. Amen. Riding through Jerusalem. Then they crucified him, but he rose on Easter.
Want to recognize our board of directors. The school's momentum isn't happening just because of our leadership team, but also because of a strong board of directors. The CGLA board is and always has been a devoted, committed, visionary board. How fitting. Mpumi Nobiva is a perfect example of how perseverance, commitment, grit, and confidence can fortify, strengthen, and empower a young woman to overcome any obstacles in front of her. Please help me welcome Mpumi Nabiva.
Such an honor for me to be here. I must say I'm a little nervous now that I know we're running out of time, because I have so much in my heart I want to say. Firstly, I'd like to thank everybody in this room, beginning with our young women and girls. If we could give them a round of applause. It has been such an honor to be in your presence. It's very hard not to get emotional. We grew up being told whenever people would visit our country and South Africa that they can't wait to see what we're going to do in the world. And sometimes that would just fly past our ears, but I saw it yesterday. I felt like I was looking right back at myself, listening to strong, self-determined young women and girls who have a spirit and a strength that really excites me about our tomorrows. My name is Mpumi Nabiva, and ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to do my very best to tell my story and lead my narrative in a fashionable manner. I'm a chatterbox. My grandmother would tell you this. So it becomes a little difficult sometimes for me to articulate truly what I want to say in very little words. So if you would please indulge me. Thank you to every person who has sewn into this initiative. Thank you to Ms. Suan, Dr. Suan Wells. You have been such an anchor. I could go on and on and on about how you showed up in my own personal life in the past few months to help me be here. I want you to know that I'm grateful for everything you have done. And this is how I know that CGLA is what CGLA says it's about, because I experienced what CGLA is about. My name is Mpumi Nabiva, and I was born in Johannesburg, South Africa. I was orphaned to AIDS when I was 9 years old. My mother was 17 when she had me. My father was 22. There wasn't much of a relationship, but I recently found out they were in love, which made me feel, you know, okay, good. it helps, you know? So I was born to a very, very young couple. In a time of turmoil, you know, I like to brag when I do my work and initiatives around the world that I was born in 1993, just a year shy away from our first democratic elections in South Africa, where Utata Rolihlahla Nelson Mandela would assume office. And so even though I was 1 year old, I was in the struggle. I've been fighting. I say this to bring humor to the situation that continues to disproportionately impact young women and girls on Sub-Saharan Africa. When I was orphaned to AIDS, my mother had such a beautiful, strong spirit. She shared her story with me. She was diagnosed when she was 25 years old. This was in the early 2000s, so you may remember a time when close to 250,000 people were wiped out on my continent because of the AIDS epidemic. And it's been very difficult unraveling the history and learning the facts and realizing that a lot of it actually happened because our president at the time did not believe in medicine as should have been, and policies weren't signed in time. And so my mother was one of 250,000 people, young people and women in majority, who were wiped out. And so I speak and I share my story because I believe that there is power in our truths. My mother was 25 years old when she sat me down. One day I came from home. I came home from school, and I had developed a reputation as a very theatric young woman who has big stories to tell. I started attending church when I was 2 years old. That's where I learned how to speak English. And my grandmother, bless her heart, she would have to sit through all my skits and recitals and plays that I would stage every Sunday. And sometimes she'd have to participate and, of course, act like she hasn't seen anything in case a visitor drops by. One day I came home in my big chirpy personality. My mother, the beautiful Nonhlanhla Nobiva, she had been home a little longer than she used to, you know, stay for whenever she'd visit. In her early 20s, before contracting the virus, when we left the township because of the political riots and we moved to the southern suburbs where my grandmother would clean houses she could never dream of owning because of the color of her skin in her motherland, and where my grandfather would fix cars that he could never dream of just sitting in, we moved into that part of the world, and my mother set sail to Jozi Maboneng, the beautiful city of Johannesburg, where gold reefs were being mined by our peoples, many, many grounds beneath our soils, people who continue to struggle and live in poverty to this day. I come from a place that has been plagued by systemic injustice in abundance, and our youth and our young continue to fall through those cracks. My mother lived in Johannesburg, where she tried many jobs. She worked as a hairstylist. She sold vegetables because she was young. She was a young mother, so she didn't have a skill set to go back to. She tried many different things, and as with many young women on the continent, ended up in prostitution. This is norm where we come from. And, you know, I recently did a People magazine documentary that I was so honored to be a part of, and shared publicly for the first time that when I was 21 years old, I learned from a woman who had known my mother, a woman from England, Miss Ellen White, who loved my mother and whom my mother could confide in about, you know, issues of womanhood, men, all of those things that she didn't necessarily have the space to have those conversations with my grandmother because of our African culture and traditions. And Miss Ellen pulled me aside when I was 21 years old, pulled me into her kitchen, went to her cabinet and got this big brown mug and said to me, "Can I please have a cup of tea with you?" And I said, "Yes, please." At this point, this is about 15 years since my mother has died. She said, "Do you know who last drank from that cup?" And I was afraid to say because I had a feeling. She says, "Colleen, your mother came into my kitchen many years ago, devastated. She had just found out she had contracted HIV, and there was nothing in the world more concerning to her than what would happen to her little girl. She says, I want you to know that your mother loved you and she carried you so much. She says, but I was so upset. I was so upset because she was such a smart young woman. How does such a smart young woman get herself in a situation like that?" And she said, I asked her, I said, "Colleen, how is it? How did this happen?" My mother responded softly, saying that the man had said that, "Well, if we were to engage in unprotected intercourse, I would give you 300 rands, which is an equivalent of about $30 extra. And I took it because Mbumi needed school shoes." I've never had to go as far as Jesus to understand that sacrifices are made for me. I come as one and I stand as tens of thousands of people, many of whom we fight so that they can have an opportunity to stand and speak their truth. I'm proud to be in the presence of young future leaders whom I know will change our world and shape our societies in ways that will challenge even people we respect. I'm proud to be in your presence. I believe in your mission. I would not be standing here had it not been for initiatives such as CGLA, powerful women who believe in us. You know, I have the honor of traveling the world sometimes, and people will ask me, "How did you do it? Like, how do you survive that much poverty and devastation?" I say, "Well, you do it because it's all you know. That's the cause you've been served." But we know, we have seen from our leaders in our lifetime that we don't have to take those cards and settle. We can take those cards and turn it up into a 10-degree notch, and maybe even 20, because I hope to be back here for the 20th anniversary, and continue shaking down barriers, defying myths, raising the status quo, confusing the life out of people, because yes, God will use the ordinary man to confuse the devil. You know, all my life I've been surrounded by really inspiring people. I met Pastor Wintley when I was 12 going on 13. No idea. I just knew that I had these dreams. I knew that not long ago I had buried somebody who I loved so much. And I didn't understand why it is that what had killed her was disproportionately affecting our young women and girls. And I didn't understand why nobody wanted to talk and address the truth of what was happening in our family. I didn't understand why I was supposed to be ashamed. And all I kept doing was just speaking up. If I wasn't at church, coming back home, staging these plays, I was talking to people about, you know, the church that came into our house and gave us a box of food, or came in and gave us a pack of blankets. Whenever people would say to me, "Mpumi, that's a lovely dress," I would say, "Thank you, we got it from Goodwill. Can you believe it? That's a great personality, but look, let me keep it real. If you're in the African continent, where the AIDS epidemic is breaking down, the last thing an African family wants is a little 9-year-old running around telling everybody in town what's happening to her mother and what's eating at her mother. But my life would change a few years later after my mother on her deathbed made me promise that I would work hard in school, be good to my grandmother, which I believe I was. My grandmother might tell you some stories, and it's about washing dishes and stuff. Don't believe that. And my mother said I should never stop believing in God, never stop working hard. And I believed in my 9-year-old mind, because I was starting to see the changes in her body, her eyes falling back, her skin tone changing, hair falling out, rash kicking in. She said, "You must go on. Go on, so that you can be everything I could never be." And in my mind, the translation was, if I don't go to school, if I'm not good to my grandmother, if I ever stop believing in the mighty God, I'm going to turn out exactly like my mother. And so it is with an honor that I stand here with a truth that was meant to bring me shame, that has killed many of my people, but here we still stand. A truth that my mother left me with so that I can continue to advocate on her behalf. To say that we are, Bishop T.D. Jakes says it so beautifully, that it is the pain of being you that is the power of being you. Yes, it is the pain of being you that is the power of being you. And when we are in alignment with our greater purpose, surely we can turn all our struggles into strengths, of course. My mother shared her story with me. I worked hard in school. When I was 13 years old, my teachers came to me. I was writing an exam. It was time to go to high school. My grandmother was worried. The boys were starting to give me attention. She was concerned about the streets because, of course, I've been left to the same social ills that had swallowed up my beautiful young mother. And one day my grandmother said, "My child, I wish I could take you to a boarding school." We were watching TV. She says, "Boarding school. Yeah, hey." I'm like, "Yeah, Gogo, it looks great." I'm thinking she's talking about the uniforms, the buildings. And she says, "You know, man, this is really good, this thing, you know?" She's watching it on TV. She says, "You know, it's like a container. I can just put you inside, close the lid, and just put you away." That's the heights our relationships had reached at that point. I was 13 years old. So, Mom Oprah knows I'm always so grateful when I share to her just how much she saved my life. For that beautiful container that costs millions of dollars, where a media mogul would fly across the Pacific, the Atlantic, to come and look for girls like me. Not only did she choose the spoons and the blankets we slept in, she chose our tiles and the gravel between our tiles. I was 13 years old, sitting in a room, not knowing what would happen next. Something in my spirit said, look up. And when I did, I saw my teachers, three of my teachers and our headmistress were standing in front of the hall, and they were just pointing at girls, while people, I couldn't tell it was girls. And Mr. Gore is just pointing, and Ms. Daniba is just scribbling names. And I'm thinking, what's going on? And they point at me, and I'm like, ooh, I thought I was in trouble, because again, chatterbox, you know. So I went back to my work. And at the end, they listed a long list of names and said, girls, please stay behind, about 40, 50 of us. They said, Oprah Winfrey, a woman by the name of Oprah Winfrey, is coming to South Africa to build a school for girls like you, and we think you should apply. What? Oprah Winfrey? Yes, you should apply. I remember that day, Ms. Daniba said, and it's a boarding school, so you might like it. She had me at boarding school. I was like, that's the container. That's the container right there. Took that envelope, ran home. We had this conversation yesterday at dinner where when I was running home, I was running to a little garage because we were so poor, we couldn't afford to live in any other form of housing. So we lived where a car would usually park and it wouldn't move, so they demarcated the space. So when I ran home, I ran to a situation of poverty, but God will find you no matter where you are, because what is meant for you is for you, and there is nothing that can ever get in the way of what is meant for a woman who is determined to rise. And so to our girls, there's much I could stand here and say, but I do want to share two quotes that I hope you will keep with you for the rest of your lives. Before I do that, and I know we're running out of time, but it's really important I say this. There'll be many times where God will speak to you. God will speak to you, and he'll give you a vision, an idea. But sometimes it won't be in the nature of what you've seen in the manifestation of this realm. It has come so that you can move our world forward. I made a lot of mistakes in my life where God would give me ideas, and you know what the first thing I would do would be? I'd turn to my friend and say, what do you think? I'd turn to the next person and say, what do you think? And these are people who love me, so of course they'll always support me, but we're talking about innovation. We're talking about moving our culture forward. We're talking about putting people of color and minority in seats and places that we desperately need them to be. Places where we need not to ask for permission or validation to be in, because it is by our godly right that we are in those seats. And so I want you to be courageous. I want you to be strong in your pursuit. And when God gives you a message, I want you to execute. You get that message and you execute. Everybody makes mistakes. Fall fast, fall hard, fail fast, learn fast. But don't ever look to the side for validation. Because you know what I learned? I learned this when my best friend, I had been asking her about this idea, and she would say, I don't know, babe, it's not you, you know? And I'd be like, oh, well then, okay. But I could never shake it, because you see, a message just never leaves you, ever. And no matter where I'd go, I'd have this idea of storytelling and using the power of our truths and our narratives to break barriers, using creative arts, rap, music, artists to meet people where they are and speak their language, leaving the plane of politics and going to the plane of humanity where people need to be seen, heard, and identified. And I would have these messages. And one day when I decided to just execute, guess who the first person who called me was about the idea? My best friend. Girl, I'm so proud of you. This is amazing. And I thought, honey, I've been trying to figure this out with you for years. But you see, the lesson there, had I been validated by anyone else but the God who has placed me here, I would have lost sight of who my God is. So when God delivers, ladies, execute. And trust that women like me, who have come from the bottom, like you, will be ready to hold your hand and pull you up. And there's no mistake There's no lesson, there's no experience that can ever take away from your grace, your beauty, your worthiness, and what makes you special. So I hope you soar, and I hope you thrive. And if you ever feel alone, I hope you turn to this quote that Mom Oprah inspired me. It's by William Ernest Henley. Out of the night that covers me, it's a poem, black as the pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul. In the foul clutch of circumstance, I have not winced nor cried aloud. Under the bludgeonings of chance, my head is bloody but unbowed. Those are our girls. Beyond this place of wrath and tears looms the horror of the shade, and yet the menace of the years finds me and shall find me unafraid. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged with punishment the scroll. I am the master of my fate, and I am the captain of my soul. Thank you for having me here, CGLA. It's an honor. I couldn't be prouder. God bless you all. This is powerful. This is beautiful. I support you and I see you. Thank you for everything you do. Keep working. God bless you. Thank you.